Hey, it's Norm from Sestit, and I'm here with
Frank Polito.
We're here at Adam's shop for another video. Interesting video this time. It's an experiment. Honest to goodness experiment. We have no idea how this is gonna end. But today we're gonna talk about technology. Are you comfortable?
Okay.
Special effects and technology. last year, Apple released the iPhone 5S, which was their first product using Touch ID. You've probably heard of Touch ID. It's a biometric sensor system for your phone to double as your password. Now this year, there are more products using Touch ID and more services using them. It's being used for things like Apple Pay, passwords, 1Password. And we wanted to see how, basically, how foolproof it was. We're not gonna hack Touch ID. People have said they've made all claims about hacking it. Last year, a hacking group over in Germany, the Chaos Computer Club, released a video showing how they spoofed Touch ID. And what they did was they duplicated someone's fingerprint and printed it on acetate, it created a relief image. And it was a pretty involved process. But we wanted to try to
More involved.
Even more involved, but basically try to understand how Touch ID works. Do you know how this works?
Why don't you explain?
So beneath this home button on the iPhone and the new iPads is basically a sensor. It's like an optical sensor, almost like a camera. There's a capacitance sensor. That's what makes the touchscreen work. So it knows, it registers that your finger is there. But basically it takes a high resolution image. What people have said is it's about 500 DPI. Which is fairly high. Mm-hmm. Apple talks about subdermal imaging, but basically it knows all the grooves and all the curves of your fingerprint and registers that, because you do have to register it multiple times, stores it locally, and so when you put your finger on there, it basically recognizes that that is your fingerprint. So we want to see if we could unlock a phone, activate Touch ID without having the actual hand there, a warm-bodied hand, maybe a dismembered hand.
There you go.
All right, so this is actually a hand cast we did a couple months ago of my hand. It's just a silicone hand cast. And based on your experience in the special effects industry, Frank, how accurate is the fingerprints on something like a hand cast?
Well, I mean, the silicone doesn't shrink or expand or anything, so it's pretty accurate as long as we got it in all the detail. This was done in an alginate mold, so the detail might be a little soft. Mm. But what we'll do today is we'll do a little silicone cast in your finger. My finger, and we'll see if we can crack it with that.
So we're talking about mold materials and casting materials. And mm-hmm. when using silicone as a mold material, you're gonna, and doing it right,
you're gonna get a more accurate casting.
It'll hopefully be almost exactly one-to-one, all like, you know, microns of accuracy.
Hopefully.
And then the casting material, also important, because you're casting resins and silicones and all sorts of stuff.
Well, the pad of your fingertip is about a 35A durometer.
When you say durometer, that's how stiff it is, how rigid.
Yeah, the durometer scale is how you measure how soft or rigid something is. There's an A scale for soft things and a D scale for rigid things. And your thumb tip is about a 35A.
Okay.
But the problem is that when you push on the button, it doesn't have enough give to kind of like flatten out into the thing. So I think we want to go a little bit softer.
So we're doing this off camera. This casting is done in a 20 durometer silicone, mm-hmm. which technically is softer than the 35 of your finger.
I think we want to go softer than that.
Even softer.
I have a 10 durometer.
That's right. You want it to be able to flatten without pushing the button.
Yeah.
Now the other piece of the puzzle is capacitance. Mm-hmm. You need to be able to activate that touch sensor in the first place. How are we going to give silicone capacitance? Because if you put a silicone finger or a hot dog on here, it's not going to activate the touchscreen.
Maybe a hot dog will.
But a silicone hot dog.
We can make hot dog fingers.
Oh, we can do that.
I think from what everybody's told me, adding graphite is enough to give it capacitance. Whether that's mixing the graphite into the silicone or just powdering the surface of the mold and then putting the silicone behind it so that the silicone grabs the surface of the graphite. We'll try it.
Like I said, this is an honest to goodness experiment. And
there's a good likelihood that we'll fail.
But follow along with the process. Let's go to step one, which is creating a casting of your finger. You're using Body Double from Smooth On, which is just a casting silicone. We've used it before.
Specifically for life casting,
For life casting, as accurate as possible. We've done life casts with it before. And you mixed in a little bit of material in it as well.
I mixed in a thickener called Thyvex. It's instead of using like Cabasil or something fumy to thicken it. It's just a couple drops of this liquid and then it gets thick.
And then in terms of the making the mold, you did a thin coating of silicone just to get into those grooves to make sure it's a strong relief, a perfect copy, and then just slathered some of that silicone on top.
Yeah, I kind of smeared it into the grooves of my fingertip and then built it up so that it has some thickness.
All right, so now it's time to wait till this cures. Okay, while the silicone mold, Frank, on your finger is curing, let's begin experiment two. Another way we thought we could spoof Touch ID is if someone left their fingerprint on a piece of glass, for example, and we captured it photographically. So we had you put your index finger right here and on some baby powder and put it right on this piece of foam core. This is basically the equivalent if you had greasy fingers and put it on glass, for example, which is what the computer, the CCC group did. So we took a photo of this. I took a macro photo, blew it up, very high resolution with my camera, and then processed it on a computer to scale it to be exactly the size of your finger. Measured it, it was about an inch tall, and then I laser etched it. So tried several variations, laser etched of different relief. With laser etching, you know,
different depths.
Different depths. Yeah. Changed the color, inverted it, but basically, use this as a substitute for your finger and then mold on top of that or cast on top of that. We're not sure if that's gonna work either, but then we also wanna create the molds here and also using silicone.
Sure. So I ran some body double onto these etched parts to see how they come out. And some of them look like they're actually gonna work. So what we wanna do is we wanna dust this with graphite and then put some more silicone on top of this. And then we can use it as kind of a finger pad. You know, because it's thin and flexible, and maybe that
exactly
will work. So let's.
So we had to do some mental gymnastics here. The photo of your fingerprint, which I blew up and high contrast it to make sure that all the curves are very visible. That was the reverse of what your actual fingerprint is, and so without inverting it, without flipping it back, and just etching that. Basically, what you're gonna get on the etch is what you would get on the foam core here or a fingerprint on the phone. And so when we create the silicone casting on top of that, this isn't the mold, this is the fingerprint.
Yes.
Okay, so put some graphite on there.
And then we'll mix up some more body double. And we'll add a little bit of graphite into the body double just to help with capacitance maybe, I don't know.
Black like tar. So the cast of your finger is about done.
Yeah, this is all solid now. So what we do is just kind of peel it off. And because it's in all the detail on my finger, it's kind of got a lot of suction.
That's good.
Yeah.
Take a look at that. You can flip that inside out, which will be fine, and see all those ridges and grooves.
So you go, internet, copy this and go hack all my passwords.
It's a good looking fingerprint.
So what we'll do is we'll put a couple different materials into this, but we have another copy of the fingerprint etched at a different DPI.
Yes.
So we'll smear some more stuff into that.
Yeah, my question and my concern with the laser etching is the resolution that you can etch, and you can change that on the laser cutter. And so I have 500 PPI, 600 PPI, and 800 PPI. I'm afraid that the
PPI or DPI?
It's not the same, points per inch.
Okay.
The higher you go, the more chance also that the acrylic will just get fused into the crevices and the dust will take away some of the detail. But that looks, I mean, you can recognize it as a fingerprint. I just don't know if it would be good enough to fool Touch ID.
You don't know if we're good enough to fool Touch ID?
Are we smarter than Apple? Probably not. All right, back to experiment one, the hand cast, the finger cast, and you're gonna put some silicone in there.
Yeah, so first thing we wanna do is hit it with a little bit of release. So this is just ease release 200.
And we actually haven't seen you use mold release before. This extends the life of your molds.
Yeah, if you wanna cast like urethane parts or something like that, this works great. It just happens to be what I have sitting around right now. And I wanna put a release on there because nothing sticks to silicone but other silicones. We're gonna be putting silicone in here. So I wanna, so I'm spraying it in and then I'm just kind of rubbing it around. So what I'm gonna do on this first is I'll get a little bit of graphite and rub some graphite into the surface, kind of how I dusted the etching.
And you're gonna be careful. We want this is really tricky because we want just enough graphite to activate Touch ID. And the activation actually, I think, happens around the ring of the home button. But we don't want too much graphite because that might take away the detail. I want to imagine Apple engineers watching this and just laughing their butts off. Those fools, those morons, they'll never do it.
So this is the rubber that I'm going to use that's the tenderometer. For this stuff, we were using the body double just because it was real thin and it'll just serve as like a pad that we put on our finger. So this one, I'll make one that's kind of a full finger, sort of like this stuff, and then I'll do another one that's just kind of
just a pad. Just a pad that we can put on top of any other finger. All right, so the castings are done. Silicone is cured. It's time to pop them out of the molds.
Yep.
So what we have here, we actually did more than one, and silicone casting from a silicone mold pops out, and how do the fingerprints look?
I think that the detail is really great. It's about as exact of a replica as you can get of your fingerprint, but you know, we'll see if it reads in the Touch ID.
And then also the silicone we use on top of the laser etching, we pulled those out as well. And the advantage of doing these is that if someone wanted to spoof another person's fingerprint, this is more likely how they're going to be able to do it. They're not going to be able to get someone put their finger in a mold for 15 to 20 minutes. Mm-hmm. They're more likely to take a photo of their fingerprint from a touchpad, from a piece of glass or something, and then see if they can laser etch it.
Yeah.
Plus, these are thinner.
Yeah, they're thinner, so that'll help with the capacitance. Like your finger, it's like if you're wearing a pair of rubber gloves and you can still activate your phone. So
let's do a first test, which is a test of capacitance. Let's unlock this phone. I'm just type in the passcode. And show that using the graphite-infused silicone, whether that works just to manipulate the touchscreen. All right, that seems to be working. Let's try it with this now. It's Frank's finger. Oh, no capacitance.
We could try wetting it. We could try...
putting silicone or graphite on top of it.
Yeah, we could try those two things.
This is tough because water just beads off of silicone. Okay, a wet finger casting. That activates the screen. Now we don't know how that's going to affect Touch ID.
So this one's dusted with extra graphite.
Let's see if that works. It does.
And it does.
Great.
So
capacitance is working.
Okay.
So here comes the moment of truth. Or failure. The moment of failure, potential failure, we'll call it that. I'm going to hit the top button of the screen. It's going to want to unlock. I'm going to show that, for example, my finger does not unlock this. Your finger does unlock.
My finger that it was molded.
Does unlock.
Does unlock.
And then let's put that on top of there.
It unlocked.
It unlocked. Holy moly.
We fucking did it.
I'm genuinely shocked. I didn't think it was going to work. Let's see if we can duplicate that. All right.
Okay.
All right. Let's do a...
This is the finger that's molded.
Right. And let's prove that this finger here does not work.
Try
does
again.
Does not work.
Okay.
Okay. Oh!
We did it.
Huge success. Test one, experiment one, a success. I'm gonna try it on with my finger. So let's talk about what did work.
Okay.
In experiment one, we did a silicone casting of your finger with a silicone mold that you carefully made also of the same index finger.
Mm-hmm.
Now, with the silicone casting, we infused it with graphite, which by itself didn't seem to activate enough to activate the capacitance ring on the Touch ID sensor. But by brushing graphite on top of it, that actually let it register as a finger.
Yeah.
And with one of our castings, we're able to unlock the phone.
Mm-hmm.
And the cooler thing even is that on the new iPhones, iPhone 6 and 6 Plus, Touch ID is theoretically even more improved. The sensor they have on the inside is higher resolution. And even on the 6 Plus, where we trained beforehand, your index finger, but not mine, it unlocks.
So now I can unlock Will's phone anytime I want.
Well, if your fingerprint was stored in it, yes. But the other thing we have to test, of course, is the laser etching process. This is taking a high-resolution photograph of your fingerprint left on a surface, laser etching it, and then creating a mold of that. So we've cut out a bunch of our laser etched fingers. Let's go back to the 5S, and let's see if this works. So here I have your fingerprint, theoretically, on top of mine. Try again. Come on, do something. So unfortunately, the laser etched and then cast silicone fingerprint doesn't work. What's interesting is that it does recognize on the Touch ID that it is trying a fingerprint, which if you put any other capacitive surface on there.
Like a hot dog.
Right, it wouldn't. It knows that that's not a finger, so it wouldn't even try. So we got it to try, we got it to fail, but we couldn't get it to recognize as your finger.
Nope. At least we got one of them.
This is really cool. We get to learn, you know, basically how Touch ID works in practice. We recognize that you don't need a warm finger. All you need is something that has the fidelity in terms of the resolution of your fingertip and also has capacitance, enough capacitance to activate the ring.
Yeah.
And so if your finger was chopped off, theoretically, it would still work.
There you go.
Touch ID tested. It's a fun project with Frank Ippolito. What else did you do? You did a bunch of other tests here?
Well, during the week when I was at lunch and stuff like that, I tried a bunch of different things. One thing I did was take a ball of clay and just push my finger into it to get a fingerprint in the clay, and then I would put silicone into there. That didn't work either. These are attempts at just doing a fingerprint in clay, so that's not enough resolution. The silicone mold it gets a better resolution, so that's kind of the way to do that.
Try different ways, and you know what? If you have any experience with special effects or casting, or you have ideas, the Chaos Computer Club, they posted their instructions. We'd love to see your videos or your attempts at spoofing Touch ID. But this is a lot of fun.
Yeah, it was cool. I've always thought about this and never, you know, really tried it, but now we kind of know sort of what works.
It's a fun experiment. Touch ID tested here on Tested. Thank you, Frank Ippolito. Thank you, Tested Premium members, for bringing this video.
Thanks, Smooth On, for giving us stuff to fill with.
Thanks, Smooth On, for materials. Again, we use our body double, we use a dragon skin, and they have a lot of materials. It's fun stuff, and it's find more of the stuff on Tested. Subscribe to our YouTube channel, and we'll see you next time.